Hi everyone, welcome to Monday. It is a gorgeous day here in California. It's around 75, so we're very thankful that the weather is cooling off just a bit. You guys know last week was super warm, 90s and even 100, so this feels absolutely glorious. But I do want to acknowledge those of you that are over on the East Coast or eastern part of the US. I know that you experienced a really, really cold weekend, and I heard from a couple of friends that they lost some of their plants in spite of the fact that they covered them up in the cold weather. So really sorry if that's you. That's a really tough thing to have to recover from that. But hopefully you had some backups planted or able to get some transplants from the garden center and get some new plants going. So let me know if that was you, if some of your garden was part of the casualty of that May polar vortex, crazy cold weather, really late in the season. So hopefully you didn't lose absolutely everything. So let me just see who is here and say hello and also greet all the mothers out there. Happy Mother's Day. Hope you guys had a wonderful day yesterday. We're able to spend some time with your family and just relax. So Pat Sella, yeah, I actually heard from Gary this morning that Gary did lose a lot of the plants that he already put outside. Hopefully, it looks like he posted a video on that, so hopefully a lot of you were able to catch that. And I'm sure he gave a lot of really good tips on how to recover from losing plants during a cold snap. Andrea, how are you? Watching from Denmark. Linda, I lost some of my nasturtiums. Yeah, nasturtiums are really frost sensitive, so hopefully you're able to get some new ones planted. The good thing about nasturtiums is they grow very, very quickly. So if you can get some more seeds planted, or even if they drop some seeds, you're going to have a lot of new nasturtiums coming up very soon. Carla Jimenez is here. Animals from eating straw, how to keep animals from eating strawberries. If you can get your strawberries up off the ground, that definitely really helps. Today's topic is how to grow kale, or some tips for growing kale and other heat tolerant greens. So stay tuned for that. We'll get started with our tips in just a moment. Sunny Bryant is here. Hi Nisha, how are you? Chris Medrano, Ran is here. Bob, hopefully things are warming up for you. The morning snow has melted. So yeah, thanks for encouraging people to give a thumbs up. I appreciate that, Ran. Jennifer Bonson, good afternoon. How are you doing today? So great to see people here from all over the world. Charles Hornick, was this a premiere? This is actually a live stream. We live stream every Monday at noon Pacific time. And then lately we've also been hanging out on Fridays for our Friday fireside chats. So a camera guy always joins me for those as well. So, okay guys, let's jump into our first tip on growing kale and other heat tolerant greens. I actually want to share a few basics first. If a lot of you already are growing greens, and lettuce is a green that grows very well in the cool weather, even takes a light frost, but once it gets over 75 or 80 degrees, kale tends to bolt and go to seed. The leaves get bitter and they're just not as good, and kale just doesn't survive that kind of heat. So it's always good to have a lot of greens growing. Have some cool tolerant ones like kale, and then some heat tolerant ones, like lettuce, and then some heat tolerant ones like kale and chard and some other ones I'll share with you in just a moment, so that you always have some fresh greens to harvest. And Chris, thank you so much for the $99.99 super chat. Really appreciate it. Appreciate all of your support here. Okay, so some good, really good heat tolerant greens to grow. The first one, and probably the most popular superfood, is kale. Very heat tolerant, also very cold tolerant. Great to grow in the summer. It survives temperatures of down to 20 degrees. And for those of you that live in a cool climate, I would love to hear more about how your kale survives the winter. It survives the winter beautifully here in Southern California, but it also survives the heat. And that's what's one wonderful thing about kale. A couple other heat tolerant greens that you might wanna grow in the summertime so that you always have those fresh harvests are in my heat tolerant green seed collection. And if you do need some seeds, head over to my website, calikimgardenhome.com, and pick one of these up. There's five varieties in here. And let me tell you a few of my favorite heat tolerant varieties. The blue Scotch curled kale is a beautiful variety. I think I might have some in this container right behind me here. Let me see if I can pull Oh, here's a leaf way in the back. Let me pick one of these leaves here so you guys can see what this looks like. It's a really pretty, kind of curly leafed kale, really beautiful, super tasty. So blue leaf curled kale is Scotch curled kale is one of my favorites. And then also, let's see here, the red Russian kale, which you're seeing in this container right behind me. It's such a beautiful variety. The stems are red, thus the name. Let me pick one here. So you can see how different it looks from the blue Scotch curled kale. I personally feel like this is a little bit more tender and tasty, but they're both great varieties. But this one is just so, so pretty. Absolutely love it. And then another really good heat tolerant variety, I don't have an example behind me here, is New Zealand spinach. This is another green from my heat tolerant green seed collection. And it looks very similar to spinach, tastes similar to spinach, but it likes the heat, which regular spinach does not. So that's also a great one. Now, if you like lettuce, a lot of the romaine varieties are also fairly heat tolerant, like Paris Cause. One that I do have in my heat tolerant greens that I've found to be very heat tolerant is called Bronze Mignet. It's a beautiful variety. In fact, I do have some right behind me here. I'll try and show you. This was covered in the heat. It's looking a little bit toasty, but I found that it did deal with the heat a lot better than some of the other varieties. So you can see here, it is kind of drying up, but it did last through about 2 weeks of 90 degree weather. Not completely dying. So Bronze Mignet is a very good one. And then what else do I have in here? I think that's fire. Oh, the chard. How can I forget chard? Chard is absolutely gorgeous. And this is the red chard here in the Heat Tolerant Greens collection. And let me just show you the beautiful, beautiful leaves here. If I can pull one out. Something's been mentioned on this one here, but you can see how beautiful this is. It's so gorgeous. It's great in smoothies and salads. Absolutely beautiful. So the great thing about the greens I just mentioned is that they all grow beautifully in a container. You can grow kale in a container, chard, any of those things you can grow in a container. And I know there's a lot of people on here that don't have raised beds, don't have a lot of space to garden, so grow them in containers. Now, you want to plant kale outside in the garden even before your last frost date. So if a lot of you might have a frost date still, you can get them planted outside. You can plant them directly from seed, or you can plant little transplants that you started indoors. So because it's cold tolerant, once you can kind of work the soil a little bit, you can go ahead and get the seed started. And as it warms up, they're going to sprout and grow just beautifully for you. Let's see if there's any others of the basics that I need to share with you guys. You want to plant seeds probably about 2 to 4 inches apart. And then as kale grows, you can thin it out if you want, or you can even pull out the little seedlings. They transplant very easily to other parts of the garden. They're not very temperamental. They're just super hardy plants. So you really can't go wrong with a vegetable or a crop like kale or chard or some of the other greens that I just mentioned. Okay, let's talk about, actually before we talk about the first tip, I wanna go back into the chat because there's so many people here and I know a lot of questions are scrolling by. Hopefully a lot of those will be answered as we go throughout the live stream. Shirley Kay asks, what about chard in the heat? Yes, it does great in the heat. That's why it's in my heat tolerant green seed collection. Does great in the heat, great in the cold. A lot of the crops in here will do well in cold, also in heat. So with summertime coming up, this is a really great seed collection to pick up and make sure you always have some of those salads growing. Okay, let's see here. Chard is very tasty. Do they need shade in temps over 85? If you can, you can shade them, but I found that they do pretty well in a higher temps as well. You might just give them that little bit of extra protection if you can. And we'll talk more about that a little bit later on in the live stream also. Okay, let's get into our very first tip on growing kale and heat tolerant greens to make sure that you have a lot of them growing. And that is similar to last week when we talked about beans, you want to plant seeds all summer long. That's really the key to having a lot growing in your garden. Get some plants in the ground, get some seeds started, and then maybe 3 to 4 weeks later, you want to plant a second wave, a brand new crop. That way, once you're done harvesting your plants, like once this container is finished, once it's kind of, you know, petered out a little bit, you're going to have a brand new wave of vegetables growing. And the reason why you can do that with kale and chard and some of the other greens I just mentioned is because they grow very, very quickly. So you're going to be able to harvest them in about 6 weeks or so, 4 to 6 weeks, depending on the weather. And then you'll have a brand new crop coming right on its heels to take its place. So make sure that you're succession planting. That's what that's called. When you plant every few weeks, it's called succession planting. Spread your harvest out. There's only so much you can do. You know, if you have like 2 or 3 huge garden beds of kale, you're gonna have a lot to harvest all at once. But if you stagger your planting, plant a container now, plant another container or garden bed in about 3 weeks, and then another one in about 3 to 4 weeks after that. That way you're using your harvest wisely. You have plenty to share, you have plenty to eat, and you're gonna be able to grow a lot over the summer months. So tip number one is plant seeds or little transplants all summer long. Definitely wanna do that with kale. And I do have a video on how to grow heat-tolerant greens. And there'll be a link in this live stream video once it uploads to YouTube. Or if Cliff, if you have that handy, if you could pop that in the chat right now, that would be helpful. But definitely go back and watch that video for a lot more details on how to grow the heat-tolerant greens I just talked about in containers or in your... Actually, that one's... I planted that. For that video, I planted it just in containers. So go back and watch that video for a lot more details. They're so easy to grow and so easy to plant. All right, back into the chat now. Let's see if we can answer some more questions for you guys on kale and other heat-tolerant greens, so that way you can have a ton of greens growing in your garden here. Okay, question from Sharon, or comment, I guess, from Sharon. Glad to have you on here today. Next week is my first planting. We start late this year. Darn freezing temps. Can't wait. Yeah, a lot of people are dealing with that right now, the late freezes that so many people have had. So hopefully, Sharon, you're able to get some a lot of great veggies in the garden. Always good to have those delicious fresh veggies to eat. Okay, if you do have a question, make sure that you put question in front of it. That way I can spot it easily. Tiffany, great question here. How big should the transplants be before they go outside? Tiffany, I'd say I like to get mine outside when they're maybe about 3 to 4 inches or so. You want them to have several sets of leaves, I'd say. You know, I always do try and push it just a little bit sometimes and get them out when they're very small, but always make sure that you harden them off or transition them to the outdoors. But I'd say 3 to 4 inches is kind of a good rule of thumb to get your plants outside. Okay, question here from Shannon. How many plants are in that pot behind you and what size is that? Great question, Shannon. This is one of my Cali Kim smart pots. This is a 5-gallon smart pots, and I did pack it pretty full in here. Kale can handle, kale chard, and I think it's just kale and chard in that pot, can handle some crowding, but I packed them in there pretty full because I just wanted to give it a go and see how it worked. I want to say there's probably 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, probably 6 or 7 plants in there. You could just plant 1 or 2 in there if you want to. They'll definitely get a little bit bigger. But I liked the nice full look, and I wanted to get a lot of different varieties. I think I have 3 or 4 different varieties, and I do have a good picture of this on my Instagram last week, I believe. But we've got red Russian. We've got, I think I put an ornamental kale in here. This is a lacinato kale back here. It's a longer type kale, and I'll show you the difference between the ones I just picked here. So in that container, we have the red Russian, the lacinato, which I think is really pretty also, blue scotch curled. We've got chard in there. So not only is it edible, but it's so, so ornamental. And I think I've even got another variety, which I don't recall what it is, maybe a premier or something like that. So that's the great thing about kale. It's so versatile. I like to use it even for a landscaping plant, just to kind of fill in the garden space if I don't have anything else necessarily to plant right there. So it's good, beautiful, versatile. You can eat it. I mean, you really can't go wrong with these greens here. Okay, let's see any other questions here. In love with Indian food, why do my transplants grow slowly in the ground, but they do well in pots? You know, sometimes I experience that same thing. It's just a little bit, you know, it's going to be different temperature. Raised beds and pots do warm up a lot quicker. once you're coming off wintertime, raised beds and containers are a great way to start because they start off warm and then things tend to get a fast start. Your in-ground garden, well, if you're in, I don't know if you're in India or if you're in another part of the country, but your in-ground garden is definitely going to be a lot colder than starting in a raised bed or container. So the plants are going to grow slower in there. Okay, let's head into our second tip for the day, and then we'll get into some more Q&A. So first tip is plant all summer long, succession plant. And by the way, I do have a video on succession planting. You can just type that into the search area on our YouTube channel, and that'll pull up the video on that. So definitely go back and watch those videos for more detailed information. And there's also a lot more details in my book, you guys. If you haven't grabbed a copy of this, you definitely want to pick it up. Lots of good container gardening tips, lots of good tips on how to deal with extreme heat like we have here, and also colder temperatures, and just lots of great information for beginner gardeners. So grab one of these on my website if you don't have one yet already. And I know a lot of you got them for Mother's Day or gave them for Mother's Day for gifts. So great idea. We do have Father's Day coming up, so don't forget about those dads coming up the first part of June also. Okay, so second tip for growing kale is to control the pests. Kale does tend to be susceptible to a couple of different pests. And thank you so much, Travel Texan, $20 super chat. Appreciate it. Love your support. First time on live stream ever. Wow, that's so cool. How long do seeds last for planting? And what are some very heat tolerant lettuces? Miami Zone 10B. Okay, seeds, usually my seeds will last a couple of years. And as far as heat tolerant lettuces, the romaines are great heat tolerance, but the heat tolerant green seed collection has tons of really good heat tolerant greens that you'll definitely want to plant in Miami. You really need some good heat tolerant greens that far south. So let me get back to the tip number two is control the pests. Definitely something important with kale because kale is susceptible to a couple of different pests that I found at least here in my area, and maybe some of you are dealing with others. But the aphids do tend to like the kale. And if you don't know what aphids are, go and look it up on the internet. They're tiny little bugs that tend to get down in the stems and get under the leaves. And they like to kind of chomp away at the leaves of your plants. The other thing that kale is really susceptible to is cabbage loopers. And I would love to see a hand up here in the chat. Those of you that have dealt with cabbage loopers, a lot of us have. They're teeny tiny little green worms that always like to chew on the leaves of your plants as well. So it's those chewing insects that are attracted to kale. So a couple things you can do though to really help kind of fend those off so that you can grow a lot of kale is, number one, just make sure that you're checking your plants every day to see if they are being attacked. That's probably the most important thing you can do. Prevention is always the best cure. So just keep an eye on things. That way you can handle a problem before it gets out of hand. Because once you have an infestation, it's a whole lot harder to control than if you just have a couple little bugs on your plant that you're able to take care of. Second thing is, if you do see little aphids or little cabbage loopers on your plants, I always like to, first off, just spray the plant down with water. Now, usually I recommend watering from the bottom as a healthier way to water. But when you're looking at losing your plant because of bugs, I always like to spray down the bugs, get them off of the plant. And you just kind of have to weigh the pros and the cons of that. So spray your plant down with water. If you can, do it earlier in the morning before the hot sun comes out. And that way the leaves have a chance to dry during the day. Spray them down with water, knock off those bugs, and a lot of times the little aphids won't climb back up on your plant and they'll go away. But sometimes you do have to check daily and really be persistent about it for a week or so. The little green cabbage loopers, what I found the best way is just to pick them off as you see them. So aphids, spray down, cabbage loopers, check underneath the plant leaves too, because they do like to hide underneath the leaves and down in the little crevices and cracks of the plant here. So definitely check for that. However, what you can do too is give them a really nice preventative spray with some neem oil. Neem oil is an organic pest control method. And you do have to, I also like to use neem oil, peppermint oil, and I am trying rosemary oil this year for the first time as a way to deter the pests. The smell will deter them and keep the bad bugs away. Excuse me just a moment. Now, when you use neem oil though, very important that you use neem oil with azadirachtin. It's a component of the neem tree, and that's the component that really helps control the chewing and sucking insects. So all the details I have in a video for you about organic pest control, make sure you go back and watch that for more details. And head over to therustedgarden.com because he does carry the neem oil, peppermint oil, and rosemary oil that will really be helpful for you when you're controlling pests organically in your garden. And I would totally recommend that you grab some, get it on hand, that way you have it to do preventative sprays and to do sprays when you do have an infestation. So very important to grow a lot of kale and heat tolerant greens is, first of all, plant them all summer long. And tip two, make sure that you control the pests. Oh, and I meant to mention too with pest control, when your plants are young, when you first get them put out, what you can do as an option is cover them with like a row cover. Now I meant to bring a piece of old sheer curtain down with me. That transparent, you know, type of sheer curtain. I had some that I use for shade cloth that I used to use in the house, but now I use for shade cloth. And you can use something like that to cover your containers or your garden beds. I don't think I have a video on that, but I'm sure there's all kinds of information out there. But you have to do it before the little cabbage moths fly around, because those little cabbage moths are what lay the eggs for the cabbage loopers, which turn into the green worms. So, you know, give that a try, experiment with it, and see what kind of results that you get. Okay, back into the chat. I know that was a lot of information for that one tip, but I definitely want to give you guys the resources that you need to grow a lot of kale. So question here from Imperious Gamer. Hello, welcome to the live stream today. I'm transplanting my seeds outdoors this weekend, but my squash already has flowers that are blooming. And they're not very big. What should I do, or am I overreacting? No overreactions here. No silly questions here. When you're a first-time gardener, you don't always know what to do with those little details. So if I have a flower that shows up on a squash plant before I plant it outside, or before I get it in my garden bed or in my container, I do like to pinch that flower off just so that all of the plant's energy can go into producing more leaves. Helps make the plant get bigger, which will help produce more squash sooner. So what I would recommend is you go back and watch the Spring Garden series. The video, I believe it's the transplanting video in that series. I believe that's the one I show how I do exactly what I'm saying. I pinch off a flower to give the plant more time to get a little bit larger. So great question. So try that and let me know how it goes. Okay, Gilda Molnar, is pak choy hot or cold tolerant? Pak choy is cold tolerant. It doesn't like the heat. It tends to bolt or shoot up that tall stalk from the middle of the plant once the temperatures get over 75 or 80 degrees. So that's definitely one that you can grow in the early spring or in the fall. Okay, Santa Ana Road Wild Man, I cut the cabbage loopers with my garden snips. They do so much damage. It really is important to stay on top of those because they can really decimate your plants. They love the kale. They like basil some years. I had them on my basil. So it's definitely a little bug that you definitely want to keep a watch out for in your garden. Okay, great tip here from Ross. I love this. I plant a peppermint all around my other plants. So far they're staying away. It grows fast. I don't have to trim it, but the bugs don't like it. Okay, great tip is that you can plant things like that do have a pungent smell, like peppermint, mint, other types of herbs that will help deter. Onions are also a good one to help deter the pests. What I found too is chives are kind of a trap crop too. I have one set of chives over, you know, under shade where it's doing a little bit better, then another set of chives around some plants, and the bugs do tend to go to those instead of going to my plants. So always a good idea to plant trap crops if you can do that as well. Okay, so let's share the third tip for growing a lot of kale and heat tolerant greens, and that is water and fertilize regularly. Now, I do like to try and address watering and fertilizing on these weekly live streams because a lot of plants are different. For example, last week we talked about beans, how they do need regular watering, but they really don't need regular fertilizing. Kale and chard, however, are different, because you're growing them for the greens themselves. They're not like tomatoes or beans where they produce a tomato or a bean or a fruit or a vegetable. You're growing them for the leaves. So when you harvest kale or chard, You need to give them a nice little dose of a high nitrogen fertilizer. And that's because nitrogen is the component that helps grow leaves, greens, and you especially need it with your leafy greens. So give them a nice high nitrogen fertilizer. Good Dirt Plant Food is my favorite. It has a 10 in the nitrogen area there. And it really gives your plants a boost. They have it in a pump bottle, which you can add to a watering can, or they do have a really nice hose and sprayer that you can just attach to your hose, and then it mixes correctly with the water that you're bringing out from your hose. It's a really easy and convenient way to water your containers, or if you're dousing down some of your garden beds. So their plant food is also available at Target. It's available on their website, which you can grab with my discount code, CALIKIM10, and that's good. I always forget their website, good-dirt.com, I believe. But you can also get it at Target. Check your local Target store, or you can order at Target online. But of course, you can't use my discount code on the Target website. So grab yourself some of that. It's really my favorite organic fertilizer, and regularly fertilize your kale, your chard, your lettuces, any of the leafy greens. Containers, I would recommend fertilizing every 10 days or so. Garden beds, every time you harvest kale or chard, I would just give them a nice little drink of some liquid fertilizer to get them off to a good start. Because once you harvest those little leaves that I just picked, they're gonna grow back. So that way you can grow your kale and your chard for, you know, a couple of months, even longer, and have a lot of greens as long as they have enough food to keep on going. So great tip to grow yourself a lot of kale and a lot of greens. Heat tolerant greens all summer long is to make sure that you water and fertilize on a regular basis. Okay, Carissa, we just talked about pest control for kale in the previous tip, so go back and catch the live stream once it uploads to YouTube. And let's check here in the chat. Tiffany, how are you? Great to see Tiffany Arnold on. Can't wait to get my greens planted. So I think, Tiffany, did I send you one of the heat-tolerant green seed collections? I know you were one of the winners in our recent 300K live stream, and I lost track of because there were so many people that that won on that live stream. Who won what? Okay, good. Thank you, and I hope you're able to get those planted very soon. You're going to absolutely love it. Okay, have you ever tried diatomaceous earth from pea butter? I have, but it's been quite a while, and from what I recall, I didn't really try it long enough to tell you what the results would be. But one reason why I didn't care for it too much, although I know a lot of people swear by it, is because I had to apply it every time I watered or every time it rained. So that to me, it just took too much time, so I like to use some things that last a little bit longer. I know a lot of you probably do have great results, so, you know, experiment, like I always say. Try different things, see what you like, see what works for you, and then come back and let us know of the results. Okay, Angela Gray, put some neem oil on my kale. Yeah, great idea to really help prevent those pests before it happens. Okay, Juliana, we're going to talk more about harvesting in just a second, okay? So hang on to your question there. Okay, this may be silly. Again, no silly questions here, Garden of E. But when planting greens in a grow pot, how many seeds? I have a 30-gallon and a 5-gallon. Okay, absolutely no silly questions. And what I would say to you is you'll have more details in the heat-tolerant greens video, which we did probably last summer. So go back and watch that. But you can plant your kale seeds. I usually tend to just kind of sprinkle them around in a circle in a little container like this. But you can plant them. If you want to be more conservative with your seeds, you can plant them, I'd say, maybe 2 inches or so apart. But the great thing about it is you can always go in, and if they come up really thickly, you can always go in and snip the little seedlings and have them for like little microgreens. So just experiment, see what you like. But generally speaking, I would plant kale seeds about 2 to 4 inches apart. And then maybe you want to thin them. If you have a larger area, you can thin them to about 8 to 10 inches apart as they grow. The farther apart you plant them, the larger the plant will be. So just keep that in mind, and then experiment as you go for the space that you have. Okay, let's see here. Joy, you can go back and watch the video on the ratio of neem oil and rosemary, neem oil and peppermint oil. I'm trying rosemary for the first time, but go back and watch that video for all the ratios of how much you need to add to your water. And I know that Gary has used rosemary for probably a year or two, and he's got some videos on how to use rosemary oil, peppermint oil, and neem oil. You can also check out his channel at The Rusted Garden for lots more details. Okay, is diatomaceous earth hazardous for earthworms? That question I don't know because I haven't used diatomaceous earth that much. So if anyone knows that, please let us know. Great question, Santa Ana Road Wildman. And I'm so glad that you're able to be off work today and join us. Usually he is hard at work, one of those essential workers helping us all here in the crazy times. So appreciate all your hard work, but I'm glad that you have a much needed day off. Catherine, how to harden off seedlings when there's a lot of rain in the forecast? Okay, you can still put your seedlings outside in the rain, but I would definitely follow the same methods that you would use when you're not. And just keep an eye on it. If it looks like it's gonna be like way too rainy and way too stormy, you know, just wait for another day or try and get them out really early before it rains. If you're concerned about it being really stormy and windy, but definitely still follow the same protocol where you would, you know, gradually increase the hours that they're getting. And even if it's a cloudy day, it's still helping your plants to get used to the outdoors. It's not just all about the sun. Even the cloudiest day will be brighter and more intense than your plant as if it was under grow light. So it's still going to help it get used to the outdoors. So yeah, just keep on rolling right along with that, Catherine. Okay, Imperious Gamer, is the transplanting into bigger pots or transplanting into larger containers in the video you recommended, Kim? Yes, it is. What I did in that video is I took my seedlings that were in pellets or in small little cups with soil, and I transplanted them into larger pots. And the reason why I did that is because my garden beds were full. It was warm enough here for them, but my garden beds were full of other vegetables. So I just needed to buy myself a little bit of time. So yes, definitely go back and watch that. And then if you want more information on container gardening, we're gonna be doing a container gardening series starting in a week or two. I'm not quite sure of the exact date. But in the meantime, go back and watch our small space series. Lots of good information on container gardening in that. And just to let you guys know, we are gonna be relaunching our small space seed collection. A lot of people have been asking about that. We're kind of revamping it a little bit for the container garden series. Gonna add a couple interesting, fun varieties to that. And we will be relaunching that in accordance with the container garden series. So definitely be keeping an eye on our website and here on YouTube for a container gardening launch and series launch too. Oh, and I meant to mention also the smart pots, they are sold out. They sold so quickly. I will be having a very, very limited supply in towards the end of the week. But again, it's very limited. It's just, you know, I'm getting them in as fast as I can. And I will be posting that on Instagram. I'm hoping that'll be on Thursday or Friday. So definitely keep an eye on my Instagram for that. So thank you guys so much for all of your happy Mother's Day wishes on Instagram. It was great to see so many of you on there and on our Friday live stream as well. Okay, let's head into the tip number four. A lot of people are already asking about this. Is tip number four, harvest young for the best flavor and harvest often. So so many people say, at what point can you harvest your kale? Well, if you harvest it when the leaves are small, I'd say about the size of your palm, but you can go smaller as well, you're gonna have the best flavor. So look, this one here is definitely much smaller than my palm. This is more like a little baby kale leaf. But the smaller the kale, the sweeter it is. Once it gets really, really large, a lot of us might have those humongous kale plants in our garden. The leaves do tend to get a little bit bitter, not better, but bitter. So harvest young for the best flavor. Harvest often. And what you can do is you don't want to take the whole plant and just cut it completely at the base when you're harvesting, that is. I'll talk about that in just a second. You want to take some of the outer leaves. Those are the ones that will be ready first. And then the inner leaves will continue to grow. And you're also gonna have a lot of new growth off the spot where you just harvested. So it's called the cut and come again method. You cut a few leaves and then they will come back or grow back. You know, give them a couple weeks or so and you're gonna see some brand new growth. But definitely harvest young for best flavor. Harvest often because it will continue to grow back. So tip number four to grow a lot of kale or heat tolerant greens is to harvest young for best flavor and harvest often. So let's talk about Harvesting time from seed is about 60 days or so, depending on your weather. It really loves, ideally, the kale temperatures will grow between 60 and I'd say 90 degrees where you're gonna see the best growth on your kale. But it will survive temperatures over 90 degrees. That's why it's one of the best greens that you can grow, especially if you live in a hot, hot area. Okay, so in just a moment, I'm gonna tell you a little kale tip that you can really help your kale plants last for a couple of years, especially if you live in a milder climate like I do here in Southern California. And I know we have a lot of Southern gardeners out there. So that's gonna be something that you're gonna really, really enjoy. Okay, let's see what questions we have before we head into our next tip here. And a free kale tip, yes. What about ants on my strawberry beds? Okay. I would suggest, Betty, that you make yourself some little DIY ant traps, and you can do that with borax and sugar. And I got a video on that, which you can go back and look up. I don't remember the exact quantities, but the ants are attracted. What I do, I just put them in like a little, like a aluminum foil tin. I make like a little tray, or you can use like a little sour cream lid or something like that and make a little ant borax trap, and then the borax sugar trap, and then the ants are attracted to that and go into the traps and die rather than going all over your plants. So give that a try and then let me know how things work. Thank you so much. 50-50 borax to sugar, add water to make a paste. Great, wonderful, I appreciate that information. And that is one great thing about our community here. A lot of people are sharing tips and tricks. There's so many people out there that are wonderful gardeners. I don't have all the answers, but most likely someone here in our community has the answers that I don't have. So I really appreciate you sharing that. Let's see here. What other questions we might have? Okay, question here from Lilith. Hi Lilith, how are you? Thanks so much for joining me today. Can lettuce and kale grow under a large tree in grow bags that gets morning sun? Okay, yes. Actually meant to mention that, so I'm so glad that you're talking about that. A great way to grow greens in the summertime and to help extend their life is to grow them in partial sun or partial shade. So great idea is to put them under a tree or even under some plants like a tomato plant or something else that will help shade it out. And that way it gets the nice cool morning sun, especially lettuce, a more heat sensitive plant that doesn't do as well on the heat. You can put it under a tree, under a taller plant like a tomato, and it will do well under there, at least a lot better in the heat than if you have it in the full sun. Okay, true, I grew kale once under a large cherry tree with a huge canopy from Pannon. Yeah, good idea. Definitely look for those little shady spots in your yard and just make things work for you. It's always fun to experiment and try those new things. Okay, let's see here. The pigeons rip kale to shreds from Elon. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry about that. I can only grow it under netting. Well, I'm glad to see that it grows under netting for you. That's a good little tip. And let me see what other little questions we have here before I move on to the next tip here. Okay, Sheila, sorry I'm late. Hey, that's fine. Took your advice for lettuce. We had a free Saturday night. Started seeds inside. I have City Garden Blend salad and a red leaf romaine named Sylvia sprouting already. Yeah, they grow so fast, and that's one of the great things about kale too, Sheila, is that lettuce and kale, when you have the right temperatures for them and you're growing them inside, it's a great way to get some seeds off to a great start. So a lot of times what I'll do is start some inside, plant some seeds outside, and then that way have kale ready at different times throughout the summer. So really good tip, Sheila. I'm glad that you're able to get some started and they're sprouting already. It's so much fun. Okay, number five tip for growing lots and lots of kale is prune it, don't pull it. So let me explain what I mean. And of course I've got a video with more details on that. But once kale has kind of reached the end of its life, or once it does start to bolt, because kale will eventually bolt, it'll grow really well for, you know, maybe one growing season, and then you will see it bolt or shoot up a tall stalk from the center of the plant. But one way that you can extend the life of your kale rather than pulling out old plants is to prune it back. And let me show you what I mean, because I have a plant right behind me that's been growing in this little spot here for probably close to about 2 years. So it's pretty crazy, maybe even 3 years. But what I do, you can see the kale here know if you guys can see. Let me raise up my camera a little bit. The kale right behind me here, it's in a garden bed and it is bolting. It's got some flowers at the top there. So when this happens to your kale, or when it's just starting to look kind of raggle-taggle or getting eaten by bugs or whatever, what you can do, rather than pulling the plant out, is you can come in here and cut off the plant right at the base. You can totally prune it all the way back, and this works for chard as well. You can prune it all the way back, cut it way down to the base of the plant, and most often it will grow back. Now, I have had a couple of plants that do die, not necessarily because I pruned them back, but they were just at the end of their life. But it definitely does help extend the life of your plants. Get a couple more harvests out of it is if you prune it rather than pull it. So I want to encourage all of you guys there, if you see your kale or your chard plant bolting from the middle, to do that, to prune it and don't completely pull it out, to get a whole new life to that plant. And especially if you're in a mild climate, you'll find that you can grow some plants 3-4 years or so and really get a ton of harvest out of it. So definitely prune it, don't pull it, to grow a lot of kale. So those are the 5 tips I have for you today. We are going to have some time here to answer some more questions, but let me just quickly do a quick review. Tip number 1 for growing lots of kale and heat tolerant greens is plant all summer long. Tip number 2 is control the pests. Tip number 3, water and fertilize regularly. Tip number 4, harvest young for the best flavor. And tip number 5 is prune, don't pull, and make sure you grab some seeds over on my website to plant yourself some heat tolerant greens this summer. So let me go back to the chat here, see what's going on, see what questions you guys have about kale and other warm weather heat tolerant greens. Okay, Cliff, great feedback. Kale will grow back from root even in a harsh climate. So great feedback, Cliff. He's in Idaho, and I know they get pretty cold weather there, and he's had a lot of success getting it to grow back even in the very, very cold. Okay, from In Love with Indian Food, squirrels mess up veggie pots. They sure do. Is there a solution? Thanks, Callie Kim and Camera Guy from New York. Okay, I'm so glad to hear that you are growing in New York. Thanks for telling me where you're from. Squirrels, yes, they are a big pain in the neck. I haven't had a huge problem with squirrels here. We have a lot of rats just in the neighborhood, and of course they always love to come and visit our garden because we have lots for them to eat. I have had some success with rats, with putting little covers over my plant, like my special tomatoes or my special watermelon. Sometimes I'll put like the takeout or carryout containers over them, and that's helped keep them away. I've wrapped rags around my special vegetables. Squirrels, I haven't had much experience with. So if anyone else has any experience on what to repel squirrels with, let me know. Maybe some cayenne pepper powder, things like that. So I would love to hear all of your successful tips. Okay, let's see here. Gina, hi Kim and Jerry and all. I hope you are well. I totally forgot about my radish bed and they grew and flowered. Now I harvested delicious pods from them. Great for snacking. Okay, great tip, Gina. I love it. Absolutely wonderful. Okay, lots of squirrels. Okay, we'd love to hear anybody's squirrel tips out there, okay? True Blue Daphne, baby kale added like basil, more basil than kale to maintain a classic recipe. Okay, you must have been talking about pesto or something like that maybe, which is always great. Oh yeah, I did want to mention some things I like to make out of kale. I love kale salad, that's one of my favorite things to make. And what you can do with kale to make it a little more tender, some people feel like it's a little bit tough or maybe a little bit bitter. So what you can do is strip the leaves off of the stem. Let me show you here with this red Russian kale. This is already getting a little bit wilted out here, but you can just strip the leaves off of the stem like this. And you can throw this into a bowl. Of course, you want to have a big bunch of it. You can kind of break it up, you know, into little pieces. And then you can put just a little bit of olive oil and kind of massage the kale to make it more tender, and add a little bit of lemon juice, maybe a little salt and pepper. Let it sit for, you know, maybe 15 minutes, and then you can add your other things that you want to put in your salad. My favorite is cranberries, like dried cranberries. I love feta cheese in my kale salad. I like chopped up apples. I like to pair some fruit with it because it really pairs nicely with the strong taste of kale to put that sweet fruit. And then we usually put like sunflower seeds on top and add like a fresh dressing, or not a fresh dressing. Well, a fresh dressing if I have something fresh, but olive oil and lemon, but a sweet dressing. Trader Joe's has one. I think it's a champagne vinaigrette of some type. So I do have a recipe on that. I think just search kale recipe and hopefully it'll come up on my channel. A lot of people like to dry it for kale chips. Haven't done that a whole lot. And you can saute it, add it to scrambled eggs. I'll just chop it up and, just put it in smoothies. It's really good in smoothies. It stores for a long time in the refrigerator, and I have like a 9x13 pan and then layer it in between paper towels to help absorb the moisture. And it will last in the fridge up to like a week or so. It's a really long lasting green, a lot longer than lettuce. Okay. So hopefully it'll help you with some eating tips and some storage tips. Okay, here's a great tip on squirrels from Florida Flower. Wow, thank you very much. I didn't know this. Squirrels hate human hair. Put some around the trellis and around your plants. Sounds gross, but works. But you know what? A lot of us might be giving our own haircuts or our family's haircuts at home since a lot of the salons are closed. So it might be a good time to collect it and try that out when you might not normally try that. Fresh landscape, cut hot peppers next to your plants. It will tempt the squirrels to get away. Okay, good tip. Great tips here. Pick it every 3 days, young leaves, to help it to make it not be bitter, to pick it for more flavor. Great tip. Vintage Vibes likes to make kale chips. Yeah, that's a great way to do it. Dehydrate it in a dehydrator or cook it on very low temperatures in the oven. So definitely look up a recipe on that. And kale and chard, they are superfoods, and we all want to be healthier these days, keep our immune system up. So definitely want to have those superfoods in your garden to keep yourself healthy and then to share it with other people. Use chicken wire for squirrels. Great tip there from Sonal. Thank you so much. Yi Vita, I think the curly kales are really sweet and delicious, but for me, they get aphids really easily, so I don't grow it except inside or in the winter. Okay, and that you bring up a great point there. Is if it's not working for you outside because you have bug issues, it does grow very easily inside. So you need a really simple grow light or a sunny window. You could probably grow it very easily in a sunny window because it's such a hardy green. But if you need to know how to set up a grow light, grab yourself a copy of my book or watch my grow light video, and you can set up a grow light for $10 or $15. Fresh landscape. Callie Kim, do you ever go to the grocery store for veggies, or do you have enough already? I hardly ever buy veggies at the grocery store. I pretty much just eat whatever we have available. Right now we have tons of greens available, so that's what we're eating. We're not eating a lot of tomatoes yet because I don't have a ton. I'm picking a few here and there, but I really just try and eat what I have in my yard and eat whatever I have in season in the garden. So great question. Rarely buy produce, and I'm really looking forward to the squash and the peppers because we love to grill vegetables. We've been having a lot of salads, so it'll be a nice variety to have some grilled vegetables as soon as the squash and peppers start producing. Okay, let's see here. Kale goes with about anything anyway. Okay, yeah, it does go with a lot. That's the goal, to grow your own. Yeah, absolutely. My goal, and I hopefully it's yours too, is to always have something to harvest. You don't have to have everything ready at once because then we wouldn't be able to eat it all, but always have something to harvest and try and plant a little something every day or every week if you can. Massage kale in my basil pesto. Oh, very good. True Blue Daphne, great suggestion. I love that. Okay, guys, we are going to close out the live stream for today. Thank you so much for hanging out with me on a Monday afternoon. I appreciate it. Make sure you tune back in for the Friday fireside, which it's been a little warm lately to light the fire, so we'll have to see what the temperature will be this Friday. Maybe we can light it this week. And join us again on Friday at 5:30 p.m. Pacific time. And hopefully we'll have a video in between. It just kind of depends on our schedule for the week, but definitely be tuning in. And make sure you follow Camera Guy over on Instagram at Callie Camera Guy. He always has some really great posts over there. And I'm CallieKim29 on Instagram. So thanks a lot for joining me, guys. Hopefully have a very good week. Bye-bye.